My name is Banky, man. Everybody calls me Banky. That's a name that I got from my grandmother when I was young and stuck with me for the rest of my life. She started calling me that because she said I used to break all the piggy banks and take the money. So she started calling me Banky. I just got released from prison after doing 33 years. I'm 53 years old. I went to prison for robbery and murder.
Brush strokes, cut throat from the low low when no love goes. Women buddy buddy like it's been that. When a me looking at the bill stack off the bubbly buddy, I've been stressed out. Let the smoke scream from my chest out. Late stuff, I really hate love from a stranger. Shit is fake stuff, only needed from you.
I never had been in trouble before, man, but I was going to school up there in D.C., and this guy had came down. He had moved down there from New York, and I got to running around with him, man, and we used to go out like in Georgetown and different places out there on the weekends and stuff, man. And we was broke one night, man, and he just told me, man, we just rob somebody, man. We can get some money, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, what? And he was like, yeah, you know, we can just rob somebody. He said, man, you got to do nothing but act like you got a gun, man, and they'll give it to you. So I never did that before, and we ended up doing that, man, and we got some money. He split the money with me and everything, and then that just, you know, became a habit. It just became a routine. You know, it was easy, and in my eyes at that time, no one was getting hurt. You know, you just really talking and just, you know, pointing gun at people or something. And the ironic part about it is most of the times we ain't even had no bullets or anything in the gun. So we was playing a dangerous game without even knowing how dangerous the game was. But we was young and we didn't even realize, you know what I'm saying, how serious what we was really doing was. I got into that like that, man, and it ended up being a habit for me, because if you ain't have money, then that's what you do, because you knew that was a way to get money. You know, and it was easier than working, because we young, we ain't thinking about working, we thinking about having money and having fun. We was doing that for a little while, man, and one night the cops got down on us, man. They got to chasing us or whatnot, and I got away and he didn't, you know. So they caught him, man, and coincidentally, that was the last time I ever seen him, you know, because his people got mad at him. They shipped him back to New York, and I ain't even see him anymore. So, you know, I stayed away from it for a while, but eventually, man, like I say, when I didn't have money, I got into it again, and, you know, and dibbled and dabbled in it, man. And then when I came down here to Virginia, I ended up getting into it again, man, which coincidentally led to these charges, you know, and sent me to prison for 33 years, first time offender. That in itself was scary, especially when you never really, you know, been in the system or, you know, or been in those type of positions. You only know about what you heard. You heard about what prison is. And like I say, up there in D.C., they got Lorden, you know, and, you know, all you heard about in there is you go in there, you know, you gonna either have to kill or be killed. So this is what we know about prison. Or this is what I know about prison. And I'm going in there with two life sentences, 115 years. First time offender, that's what they gave me. Well, at the time that I went to prison, they was just coming out with this three strike law, where they saying that if you had three of the same type of charges of the same caliber, then they can give you the habitual offender charge, which means that whatever amount of time they give you, you have to do like 90% of it, which was crazy. So, you know, you get 25 years and you will be locked up almost 24, you know. So at the time, I had already had been convicted of murder charge, and I was still going up for the robbery charges, what they considered is violent offenses, so they all go together. Well, for the murder charge, they had gave me like 97 years. That alone, if it falls under the habitual offender, I would never get out again. So my lawyer, he came to me, he said, man, look, they trying to give you a plea bargain, man, you know, you'll have a chance to get out. You know, and at the time, like I say, me being, you know, ignorant to the law, my family being ignorant to the law, I'd never been in trouble before, no one in my family has. So we don't know, we going by what the lawyer is telling us to do. And he's telling me that it's in my best interest to take this plea bargain for two life sentences. And I'm like, in my mind, all I heard is two life sentences. He was like, yeah, but it's not what it sounds like. It's gonna all be run concurrent. Even your time for the murder charge is all gonna be run concurrent. And you'll start going out for parole in 12 years. You're a first time offender. You're probably gonna get out if you just keep your nose clean, this, that, and the third. So I'm listening to this, thinking in my mind that this is my best option, because he's saying if you don't, and you get convicted of just one of these charges, and I had like four or five more charges to go up for, he said, if you get convicted, they gonna hit you with the habitual offender. So you'll never get out. So at the time, you know, it seemed like a no-brainer. So I did it, and it didn't turn out to be what he said it was. You know, I didn't even go up for parole 18 years. So the 12 years was, that was all a hoax. But like I say, a lot of people don't understand this, and a lot of people probably wouldn't understand this. It's a simple statement, but it's a true statement. It's the easiest thing in the world to get into prison. It is the hardest thing in the world to get out. Because even when you go in there, even if they make a mistake, even if they miscalculate something, it doesn't matter. It's still going to be hell trying to reverse what has already been done. So once you get in there, man, it's, you know, that's just what it is. You know, I know people have been fighting their cases for 20, 30 years, and it's been a mistake. And coincidentally, that plea bargain that I had to take to not get the habitual offender, here it is 30-some years later, and that whole law was misapplied. It wasn't even intended to be the way that they proposed it at first. It was supposed to be that if you get one charge and come into prison and get out and come back and come back, the third time they hit you with that, they was doing it like if you had three of the same caliber charges, that's what they was doing. So right now, people are actually getting out of prison because of that law was misapplied for 30 years. It's done, it's over, you know, I did the time, I'm out here, I'm just trying to live and just be happy and put it all behind me. But the experience was unlike anything that I can really explain to you. I can only tell you, you know what I'm saying, as I reminisce in my mind about things I went through and how I felt at the time. And when I speak about it, it comes back up in my memory. But it's being out here for less than 90 days, it still is like surreal. It's almost like a dream. It's like I actually went through all of these things that I went through. And I'm just happy to be alive, because there's a lot of times I thought I wouldn't be, you know. And there's a lot of times I didn't care if I was, because that's just how rough the ride was. Just going in there the first time and hearing all the stories and going through all the things that I had to go through to just to be processed in, you keeping all this in your mind, like, what are you going to do? How you going to do this time? Or what are you going to see when you get in here? And then when you get in there, it's just so in your face and it's so raw that you have no choice. There's no more thinking. You are actually in it and you got to deal with it. I went to Southampton when I first came in and receiving, and they used to call that gladiator school back when I was going through there. And it wasn't nothing but a bunch of young guys, man, fighting, stabbing, you know, running around, robbing people and stuff like this. So you in a caged in small environment where all of this is going on is nothing like the big world, because when you're out in the big world, you can have a problem with somebody and you may not never see them again. They may be cross town or whatever, but in prison, everything is in a microcosm. It's right there. You ain't running away from no problems. You're going to either deal with them or they're going to deal with you. I went in there and started fast. I probably was in there less than 30 days and got in a fight because of what somebody else did. And that fight facilitated them saying that they gonna move me. So my receiving got cut short because of something that was out of my control. And I ended up getting moved into 500 Spring Street, which, you know, they called the Wall back then, which was the most notorious prison in Virginia at the time. You know, this is where they housed all the killers and the death row and everything. This is what it was. They just took me straight in there, man, with a duffel bag, like the old army bag, with gave you clothes, man. They even did that old stuff that they used to see on TV where they put the dye and the lye or whatever you call it on you to make sure you didn't have crabs and all that stuff, and wash you off with the little water hose, process you, gave you your duffel bag full of clothes and sheets, and took you to your room and let you fend for yourself.
So I want to go back to when you were at receiving, and you said that you weren't there for 30 days before something jumped off and you would end up getting shipped to a notorious prison here in Virginia called the Wall. You know, can you tell me basically what happened with what would lead to you getting shipped off of Southampton?
Yeah, you know, we used to line up to go everywhere, to go to Chow, go to Rec. Everywhere we went, we lined up. So we lined up to go out there, and like I said, it was a bunch of young guys. I was young at the time, you know. It was a bunch of young dudes, man. They had this Italian dude, and he was beefing and arguing back and forth with a couple of guys. We got in the line to go out to Rec or either Chow. I'm like two dudes behind him. So there was some dudes was throwing some stuff, hitting him in the back of the head. Little, you know, like paper balls or whatever. So he turned around and he said something. And I didn't know if he was talking to me or talking to them. So they laughing and they joking. And they threw something else and hit him. And he turned around and bypassed the dude that was right behind him. And I was the next dude and he swung on me. So he hit me. So the first thing I did was defend myself. And I ended up beating him up, you know. And, you know, I always was told, like I say, your first example got to be your best example. So I beat him until I was stopped. And when they stopped me, they, you know, balled me up, the COs or whatnot, and took me and threw me in the hole. And they came and got me the next day, and the captain was talking to me, asking me why was I, you know, starting fights and whatever. I told him I didn't start a fight, man. I said I just defended myself or whatnot. He said, yeah, well, you just coming in, and I see right now you're going to be a problem. And I think they looked at the amount of time I had and the charges I had and me already in there, and I'm in a violent incident. And they shipped me off. I was gone probably within a couple of days. That's why I say that's when real prison began right there. When I got up in there with them, that was real. Because as soon as we walked in, I walked in with a couple other dudes, man. And they was whistling like the cat call whistles and everything when we was walking in. And these four dudes. So they hollering and screaming and stuff while we walking in. And my skin started to boil. I'm like, I know they ain't talking to me, you know, but that's just the environment that I was in. You know, so it got real, real fast, you know.
You know, talk about your mind state with the fact that you considered yourself a smaller guy. What was your mind state with that playing into you going to somewhere as vicious and violent as the wall?
Oh, yeah, I was small then, man. Coming into prison, man, I probably was like 145. I was a boxer, you know, trying to be, you know what I'm saying, professional boxer. So you fight in weight classes, and my weight class was welterweight. That's 145, 146 pounds. So I was a little dude coming into prison. And when you get in that prison, man, and you get into the wall, especially in the 80s, man, they got dudes in there that was like 200-300 pounds, all muscle. So, you know, dude can easily manhandle you no matter who you are. Now, by no stretch of the imagination, I felt like I could fight. And I could fight with anybody, but that wasn't the issue in there. They killing in there. They not even coming at you trying to fight one-on-one anyway. You know, there's nobody just standing up telling some, yeah, let's fight. Nah, that ain't what's going on in there. You know, this is a vicious world. These dudes take what they want and do what they want. So my mind state was that I'm not trying to hurt nobody, but even more so than that, I'm not going to let nobody hurt me. You know, that was my whole mind state. If somebody gonna try to hurt me, I'm gonna do whatever it takes to make sure they don't hurt me. And that was by any means necessary. And that's just how I felt. And knowing that I had the amount of time that I had, I knew that whatever incident I got in, I had to set an example to make sure that won't nobody gonna mess with me and I won't gonna be messed with. But at the same time, you got to realize everybody else got that same mentality as well. So this is what makes the violence even more violent. And now, in retrospect, I look at it, I feel like men, and this is just my philosophy, I feel like men don't respect nothing but violence. I feel like a man is not going to respect nothing but violence. There's nothing you can tell him. There's no way you can scare him. There's no way you can persuade him more so than violence. He going to listen to that if he don't listen to anything else. And it doesn't matter who you are, what color you are, what size you are. If you have the ability to produce violence when it need to be produced, that's what a man is going to respect. He's not going to respect your size. He's not going to respect your mouth. He's not going to respect your reputation. He's going to respect the fact that you will create violence. And so that's what you have to be, and that's what you have to become when you come in prison, even if that's not you. Because if you don't, you will be gobbled up by any means necessary. They would do anything to you. They would take you, take everything you own. They will rape you. They will make you into a woman. They will do anything they want to do to you because there's no mercy in it. So when you know that and you see that, it changes your whole mentality. You know, you go from being a person that's just want to get through the situation to being a person that says, I have to survive no matter what. The catch 22 is, even if you defend yourself and you hurt somebody or you end up killing somebody, whatever the case may be, it's not going to matter that it wasn't your fault. It's not going to matter that you didn't start it. None of that matters. So you damned if you do and you damned if you don't. And so the only way you can even avoid that is not being in there. But once you are already in there, these are the only options that you have. the only options you have. So I choose option A, and that is to be violent and be the most violent I can be to make sure won't nobody hurt me. And that's the way I live. That's the way I did my whole bit. And eventually people ended up respecting that, and they ended up understanding that if you mess with me, it's going to be a price to pay. You know, and sometimes it might be a price you're not willing to pay. And at the same time, it goes both ways. I can lose my life at any time, but I would rather lose my life trying to defend my life than just lose my life by just laying there and letting anybody do anything they wanted to do to me. That's the mentality of the war. And once I got in there, I learned that real fast. I think I might have been in there maybe less than a week, and I seen the dude get killed. I seen a dude get stabbed so many times. I had never even seen nothing like that on TV, to see a dude getting viciously stabbed like that, not even in horror movies. And I just sit there and watched it, and I was in awe. I couldn't even move, you know. And it just happened so fast, and it was so nonchalant. And the dude just got up and put the knife back in his waistband and just walked up and down the tier like it wasn't nothing happening. And the guy was just laying down there in a pool of blood. And he laid there until wreck was over and they cleared the whole part out. He just laid for hour or better, you know. And they didn't come in and try to help him. They didn't come in and try to get him up or nothing until it was all over. So once that set in my mind and I seen that and I know that that could possibly or potentially be me, it changed everything about me. So I was like, I got to get me a knife. Because in there, a knife is the equivalent to what a gun is out here. If you got that, you're going to feel more secure. You're going to feel more safe. You're going to feel like you can at least have a chance to defend yourself. So that was my main thing. I got to get me a knife because I was a little guy. And the knife is going me, I probably die, you know, and I wasn't going to have it. So, you know, I set out to get one, and I eventually got one probably within a week. And
tell us about that experience getting that knife. I remember you shared that with me.
Yeah, the guy, I asked him about a knife. It was an old guy in there. He had been there a long time, and I heard that, you know, he's a guy to see about anything. So I pull up on him, and I asked him, you know, what would it take for me to get a knife? And he asked me, do I have any money? I said, nah, I can get some. You know what I'm saying? So he was like, well, I see you, man. I see you going to the division. He said, can you get some cash? I said, how much? You know what I'm saying? He said, man, you got to give me at least $40, $50. So I was like, all right. You know what I'm saying? I said, I can do that. So he said, you get that, then come back and talk to me. So I made sure that happened, and I got the money, and I went to him, and I gave him the money, and I'm expecting to get this knife. Mind you, now we in prison, so I'm thinking I'm going to get some type of homemade knife, but it's going to be nice because I'm paying for it. Man, this dude gave me a knife, and it's in a paper bag, and I can feel that it's big and thick. But he gave it to me because we incognito. I got to take it and get away from his cell, get back to my cell, open it up or whatever. When I get in there and I open this and I see this knife, man, it is the best way I can describe it to you is like a Rambo knife that you see in the movie Rambo. Long knife with the jagged edges on it, had a rubber grip. It actually had a compass on the back of the knife. So I was excited to have it because I felt safe now. I felt like in order for somebody to get to me, they had to go through this. But I was also terrified because I'm saying, I just got here, and if I can get this, what else is out there? You know, what else is out there in this part, in this block? So it kind of scared me, you know what I'm saying? So it gave me security, but it kind of scared me because I couldn't even imagine someone stabbing me with the knife that I had. You know, I felt like I would surely die without a doubt, you know what I'm saying? So if somebody got something better than that, I ain't want no parts of it. So, you know, like I say, when you go through those type of experiences, it changes everything about you because you know now every day that you get up, your life is on the line. Because I can promise you this, I don't care what they tell y'all or what you've heard, there's no one gonna save you in prison. It ain't no guard gonna get in front of no knife for you. It ain't no guy gonna get, it's no one gonna save you in prison but you. That's a fact, you know, that's a fact. You could be right there getting stabbed and the warden can be there. He's not gonna jump out there and grab nobody. He's just gonna use his voice and say, stop. Put the knife down. I've seen it over the years several times. Dudes getting stabbed to death, and the people are just saying, put the knife down, yelling. They're not going to jump in front of it for you. So you're going to have to be able to defend yourself. And once you come to that realization, it changes something about you. It changes something about you, and you are never the same again. And over the course of my doing time, I've seen so much violence, man, that I don't even like to see violence anymore. I don't even like to see it. You know, a lot of people, they'll run to violence. Oh, they fighting over there. Oh, they doing, and they'll run over, see it. And I heard, I go the other way. I don't even want to see it. You know, I just don't, because I'm overdosed on it. You know, and I don't even like it no more, but I understand it's a necessity in prison to survive. It is a necessity. If you do not have that in your DNA, you would not survive in prison, because, like I say, there's no mercy. There's no one is going to say, oh, well, he don't bother nobody. Oh, he's a good dude. Or, oh, he's a Christian, or he's a Muslim. Or they don't care, man. If you got something that they want, they going to take it. They gonna come take it. It's up to you to make sure they don't take it. And if they take one thing, they gonna come back and take everything. All day, every day in prison. That's just how it is. I see older cats in prison that people take advantage of. You know, a lot of the things I got into in prison more after I was established and I knew who I was and everybody else knew who I was because of other guys trying to advantage take older people or weak people. I don't even like to be around that, because I feel like if you do that, then you less than a man, because you're not going to do it to me. So why would you do it to somebody that you can get away with it from? So a lot of times I spoke up on those issues, and those issues right there caused me problems too, you know. And like I say, it's a no-win situation when you're in prison. No-win situation. Every time you get in an incident, whether you're right or wrong, you're still going to be wrong, because you're still going to the hole, you're still getting the charge, you're still going to take setbacks. Right or wrong. So the bottom line is, you're always going to be wrong. Whenever something happens, you're going to be wrong irregardless. So you have to pick your battles in there, because you're going to have battles, but you're going to have to pick and choose the ones that you're going to make a move on, because you can be minding your business and you still going to have problems, because that's just the nature of where we at. Life in prison, man, is nothing like what people out here in society who have never been locked up think it is. It's not even close. And I wouldn't have understood it. And there's a lot of things that goes on in there. When people hear it, they either think you embellishing or you exaggerating, or it's not true. And I learned that fast too. And I got to the point one time where I was doing time that I didn't even tell my people a lot of things that was going on, for a couple of reasons. Number one, because I didn't want them to worry as much. And number two, I didn't want them to think that what I was telling them was exaggerated, or what I was telling them was meant to get some type of reaction out of them. Because, like I say, it's hard for people to believe the life that people actually live in there. And when I go in the visit room, I used to go in there, man, and when I knew I had a visit, I'd shave, man, and get a haircut and everything, and go in there and be smiling and try to enjoy the hour or so with my family. And I would think, if that's all they see when they come up there, sometime I used to think that's what they think my life was like. But I would literally leave there and go back there and be so drained, mentally drained, from just being around people who actually care about you and people who actually love you. I'd be so mentally drained. I go back, man, a lot of times, and go in the cell, man, and just lay down and fall asleep. Because when you in there every day, all day, all your head is on a swivel. You don't know what's going on. You always worried. You're always thinking about, you know, what they doing over here. And then just to be in a setting where you don't have to think about that, just for an hour or two, and around people who actually like you, love you, care about you, is just mentally draining. You know, and a lot of people don't understand that, because when you're in prison, you walking around people every day, even if they act like they like you, most of them really don't. You know, and in my case, I know most of them really didn't. They, if they could kill me or hurt me and thought they can get away with it, they probably would have did it, you know. But everything in there, like I say, is repercussions. So people are not going to do nothing that they think they can't get away with. They're only going to do things that they can get away with. And they knew they wasn't going to be able to get away with doing anything to me unless you kill me. So you can be around people every day that literally talk to you, speak to you, smile at you and everything. And you can drop dead tomorrow, OD off of dope tomorrow, and they'll walk right over your body and be talking about you like, oh, he was a dumb dude. I told him. But they're smiling at you today. So you know it's a lot of fake love in there. There's a lot of fake like in there. So to be around people in that visiting room that you know care about you, man, is mentally draining to you because you need that. You need that compassion. You need that stuff to keep you human, man, because in there you can turn into an animal. Because you live like one every day. You eat like one. You live like one. They treat you like one. They look at you and look through you, look past you. You could be literally talking to an officer 5 feet away from you, and they'd turn around and look at you like you the scum of the earth. But they're talking to another officer, and they smiling and they laughing, and you ask them something, they turn to you, their whole demeanor change, like you bothering them or something. But this is what you get used to.
You've only been out here for maybe 70 days at most after these 33 years that you've served. You mentioned how prison can turn you into an animal because it's basically how they look at you and treat you. And that was a way that you had to probably live for a majority of the time that you were locked up. What has this been like for you out here since getting released?
Oh, it's been amazing since I've been released. My theme saying now, man, is I can't complain. I won't complain. You know, because like I say, I've seen worse days, man. My best day in there is it don't even compare to my worst day out of here. It doesn't even compare. It's just that much, you know what I'm saying? It's like for real, everything is just so surreal that you sometimes I don't even believe that this is really happening. Especially like my first couple of days out, you know. Man, to get in that car, to first of all, to actually walk out of that gate and not have handcuffs on, not have shackles on, you know. I had never did that in 3 decades. 3 decades, I have never did. So when I actually walked out of the gate, the same gates that I sit there and watch for 30-some years that I couldn't get past, they actually opened it and let me just walk straight out. That's amazing. That was just amazing feeling. It was something that was just so surreal to me. And to get in that car with my mother, and to be driving home with my mother probably was the best feeling I had, even surpassing them telling me that I made parole. You know, even surpassing that probably was the best feeling, to hug my mother and to actually get in the car and be on my way home with my mother, man. That was amazing. That was the best feeling I've had, and I'll never forget that. You know, no matter how long I live, but just to be out here now and to be around people that love me and people that care about me, man, it's just a major difference. And it motivates you. It makes you want to do well. It makes you want to, you know what I'm saying, be successful. It makes you want to, you know, validate the fact that they loved you enough to stand by you. They loved you enough to still be there for you. Because there's a lot of people I know that did the amount of time I did. They come home to nothing and nobody. You know, because that's what people in society tell you to do. Forget about the people in prison. Oh, he did this or he did that. Okay, but if everybody in life was judged from their worst moment for the rest of their life, what's the purpose in keep on living? What's the purpose? You could never advance. If someone told you that your worst mistake, they're going to bring that up to you every day, and this is what we're going to judge you by. What's the purpose? You can never advance in life. You can never get past that. So you need to be forgiven because everybody deserves a second chance. Everybody makes mistakes. Some people's mistakes are greater than others, but they're still mistakes. And I use that and I tell people that if I steal a car and you steal a piece of gum, by definition, we're both thieves. You know, but people like to judge people, but they don't like to be judged. So, like I say, getting out here in society and just being able to walk around, just being able to eat in a restaurant. And I came out here in the coronavirus, you know. And people are telling me, oh, man, wait till this is up. It's going to be so much better. So it's great to me now. You know, it's great to me now. It's 100% better than what I've had for 3 decades. 100%. And I ain't even been out here 100 days. So whatever is after this or whatever it is doing this, I'm happy, you know what I'm saying? Because like I say, I can literally wake up in the morning and decide, you know, what I'm gonna do. I can literally wake up in the morning and go see my grandkids. I can go see my daughter. I can talk to my son. I can go see him. I can see my mother. I can hug her. I can kiss her. And she's in her 70s, you know? And there was times where I didn't know if I get out here. I've lost so many people since I've been locked up. So many, I can't even count. And when you in there and you lose people, I can't even explain the feeling. It's nothing you can do. It's nothing you can do. You can just sit back in your cell and just wonder and say to yourself, well, this is somebody I grew up with. This is somebody, your grandmother, you know, I've lost my grandparents, you know, all of them are gone. You can just look back and say, well, I'll never see her again. Never see her again. So that's a hard pill to swallow, you know, when you put yourself in a position where you took yourself away from everybody who love you and everybody you do love, you know. And I think that's what a lot of people don't understand too about doing time. I think that's probably somewhere deep in psychology why they call it doing time, because that's actually what they're taking away from you. When you get locked up, that's what they're doing. They're putting you in a position where you will be away from everything you love and everybody who loves you and everything you love to do. And that is the purpose of, that's your punishment. That's your punishment, because when you're in prison, all those things are removed. So that is the punishment. And the irony of the situation is that everything in this world is judged by time. Everything. So if they take that away from you, it's like saying to yourself, what would you give? How would you give someone something if you know that that's all you had? You wouldn't, if you wanted to feed somebody, but this is all the food you had, would you give them all your food, not knowing what you got left? That's what we do when we lock ourselves up, when we put ourselves in those positions. We're giving away time that we don't even know what we got left. So that's why they call it time, because they're taking away the most valuable commodity that you have. And when you do the amount of time that I have, 30 years, 33 years, who's to say I got 33 years left out here? Who's to say I got 33 days? Who's to say I got 33 minutes? So you never give away something that you don't even know what you have. You know, you don't even know what you have left, so why would you give it away? See, that's the price that you pay, and that's the price that I paid. Now, I pray that I, you know, have a long, you know, prosperous life, but who knows? You know what I'm saying? Because that's already gone. I can never get that back. And a lot of dudes get out and they try to chase that and get that back. And that's what get them in trouble. That's what get them back in the same position. You know, but you just got to come out here and just enjoy this life, man, that's out here. Because every day is a beautiful day. And you get up every morning and you try to make the best of what you can make of it. And that's what I'm trying to do. I'm not going to complain. I did the 33 years. I'm not going to go be mad at nobody. It's people out here that I see now, and I didn't even see him three times in 33 years, but now I see him, and I don't have no grudges. I don't even bring it up, you know, because it's water under the bridge, you know. And a lot of times people, one of my worst, the worst sayings I used to hear when I was locked up, it used to annoy the hell out of me when you talk to people on the street and they say, well, I ain't put you there, you put yourself there. Okay, well, if you love me, then I know you didn't put me here, because people who love you don't help you get into trouble. But they help you get out of it, and they help you get through it. So don't throw that in a person's face that got in trouble. You didn't do it. Help them. If you love them, help them. Help them get through it. Help them get over it. You know, don't throw it in their face what they did, because what's done can't be undone. It's already done. So now you have to try to heal, and you have to try to be better. So if you're going to hold that over somebody's head for the rest of their life, they'll never be able. They never had any motivation to do anything. Never. You know what I'm saying? So you have to get past it. We have to be healing people, man. We got to support each other, man, and love each other and try to help people get through, because everybody going to stumble. Some more than most, but everybody is going to stumble. You know, so like I said, I'm just happy to be out here. I got things in life that I want to do. I got things that I want to try to accomplish. And I know it's going to take time, because I'm already, you know, behind the eight ball. But I ain't going to complain and I ain't going to whine. I'm just going to buckle down and get it done. Because it's like in there, you wake up any day, anything can be happening. I could wake up in prison tomorrow and it be a riot. Or I could wake up and it be a okay day. Or I can wake up and walk out the cell and everybody fighting. Or I could wake up and walk out the cell and somebody fighting me. So it's undetermined what will happen every day in there. But out here, you can determine what will happen, because you can buckle down and make something happen for yourself. And whatever I got to do to be successful out here, that's what I'm going to try to do. And I can say, I know it's going to be hard, but I ain't crying. I ain't worrying about it. I just got to do whatever I got to do, you know, because I just love being free. And I ain't never going to be locked up again, never.